Hey everybody, welcome to Pop Culture Philosophers. I'm Rockin' Robbie Billups, and it's time for the weekly comic book review. That's right, everybody. Thanks for checking out the video. I am Rockin' Robbie Billups. This is the weekly comic book review. It's the show where I read a lot of comic books, and I'll let you know what I thought about them. But before we get into that, I got to give a mad shout out to Chris Merkwichka over at patreon.com/PCP. Homie, you've been supporting us. You go above and beyond every single month, every single week. I really do appreciate it. In fact, I believe that Chris's lady painted these, and they sent them to me. I got them today. It's a Dr. Doom holding a spicy tostada, the discontinued spicy tostada, and we got Dr. Doom and the cocaine bear from the meme that, you know, LaRocca used in the Dr. Doom book, riding a tostada sled a la Calvin and Hobbes. Yo, thank you so much. That is amazing. These are definitely going to hold a special place in my heart and here in the Huntsville attic. Now let's get on with the pick of the week. This week's pick of the week is I Breathe the Body, number one. I Breathed a Body, number one. This is going to be a hard sell for some people, I believe. This is probably not definitely going to be for everybody, but I loved it. It's a new one from Zach Thompson, Andy McDonald, Triona Farrell, Hassan Osman El Hal. That's a star-studded lineup. I got an advance look of this book, and I did an advance review for it already, and I elaborate a little bit more on my thoughts there, but I've also had the benefit of reading issue two. Now, issue number one does a great job of setting up the concept, which is basically this. This is set in the not-too-distant future, and it's involving biotechnology, which is something Zach Thompson's been exploring a little bit in his recent work, including Lonely Receiver. And it's about a social media influencer who's like the biggest one ever. His fame keeps rising. He keeps pushing that envelope. It's about the corporation that surrounds this dude. So it's about the manipulation of social media by corporations. But it's also about the fascination with influencers and the life of an influencer and all kinds of things. And then what happens if this influencer does the most heinous, insane, crazy thing at the peak of his height? Does something just wild and pretty much unforgivable. And I'm going to tell you what, this job does a great job of setting it up. There's a mystery going on there as well. It starts off very surreal, and then it kind of kicks you into this futuristic world, and you just go along with it. And the way that Zach Thompson, through the script, introduces the characters, the elements of the story, the weirdness, even though at times not explained, but there's hints of weirdness there, but it does a great job of building up this world, these characters, and when you get to the end, it just, you're like, what? And you gotta really think about what you just saw. That was absolutely crazy. And issue number two, it gets even crazier. This is by far my pick of the week. Andy McDonald's artwork provides a grit, a texture to it. It's rough, it's edgy, it is horrific at times, and it's also like a sly, satirical type thing at times. Overall, I really like this book. It's got great lettering. It's got excellent coloring. This one just really captured it. And I really like how innovative Zach Thompson has been with some of his ideas and his ideas of the melding of organic living tissue and technology and weird things like that. And that's just set dressing. It's not even what the book is about. The book is definitely looking into the social media culture, the influencer culture, and the corporate control of that, and the passion and the excitement and the obsession. And then it pushes it way far. And you just wait till issue number two. This one's great. By the way, PCP Army member Brett Hess, once again, congrats on your exclusive cover for I Breathed a Body. Mine should be coming in the mail. Hopefully in the next couple days, we'll definitely be showing it off. I Breathed a Body, number one. Not going to be for everybody, but if you're a big horror fan, if you like your horror to be a bit challenging, if you like it to be maybe a little bit more cerebral, if you like it to be body horror and fungal horror and really wild, crazy ideas, and you want a book that you gotta kind of let sit for a minute, check that one out. Let's jump over to Marvel. King in Black number three is here. King in Black number three was a pretty decent issue. It was all right. Things are happening really, really fast. Now, we just got news that at the end of King in Black, which leads to Venom 200, that is in fact Kate and Stegman's last issue on Venom. Their story is done. So, is it living up to its height? Well, right now, what we have going on is that Null has taken over, and we keep having all these different heroes show up, be like, oh, don't worry, I'm super awesome, I can take care of it, and then they get completely murked, right? Now we got Thor. Thor makes his appearance. He's going after Null. This is basically a big fight, a lot of setup, some really cool, explosive, and kinetically charged action shots from Ryan Stegman. It does feel a bit rushed, a little looser than typically some of his more defined concepts or whatnot. But overall, I'm still enjoying this one. It's not really doing too much with moving things very forward, but we're still in this zone right now where the heroes need to understand how utterly hopeless this is, but they keep dangling threads of hope, and I really liked the end of this and what it's leading into. King of Black number 3, pretty solid. If you've been liking the King of Black stuff, there you go. I didn't read any of the King of Black tie-ins this week, and I feel really good. Plus, there wasn't an issue of Spider-Man. Maestro, number 1, War and Pax. So this starts a new miniseries because Maestro, the initial 5-issue series, just wrapped up, explains how Bruce Banner grows old and takes the term Maestro to as a title. This now, War and Pax, is how he is going to now conquer the rest of society. And I like this. I liked it a lot. I really would have liked to see Herman Peralta on the artwork, but Javier Pena does a great job. Peter David knows this character. He knows this world. He's literally responsible for it. So he's a very consistent writer, and provides a very consistent script here. I didn't like the Hercules aspect of the previous Maestro book, but now that that's all done, I'm really digging this. This is a cruel and vicious Bruce Banner taking over the world and with no holds barred, and I liked it a lot. Maestro, War and Pax, number 1. Iron Fist, Heart of the Dragon, number 1. This is a new miniseries from Larry Hama with artwork by David Wachter. I do want to say this. I really like the art in this book. I really do. It's got this nice textured grit to it, but it's solidified, so I actually really like the art in this book. I did not like this book, though. The story was all over the place. It throws you right in. There's no explanation. I felt lost the entire time. It never paid that off. I'm okay with feeling off and lost when a book first starts, as long as that's a payoff for something towards the end of the book, where you're like, oh, that's what's going on. No, you get none of that. It's just kind of like maybe the first 5-10 pages were just gone, and you just kind of jumped in or something. But all in all, this was a weak story for me. I've read better from Larry Hama. I did like the artwork. I thought that was pretty neat. It's always cool to see some nice martial arts action, especially against like zombies or whatever. But the book did not really do much for me. So unless you're the most hardcore Iron Fist fan, I really could not recommend that one this week. Let's check out the X books. We got X-Force number 16. I loved this issue. This was fantastic. I am so relieved now that Ten of Swords, which I will say that overall I enjoyed Ten of Swords, but I'm relieved that it's done so that we can get the focus back on what these books were doing and what X-Force was doing with this infection on Krakoa. They've been bringing that up with they're building it back up. Some great Quentin action in here. I love the Forge and Wolverine dynamic in this book. Benjamin Percy knows how to handle that. Kassara's artwork is just gorgeous. I love it. And in this issue, you got the X-Force team kind of dealing with a underwater monster type situation. Really cool stuff. Great artwork. Great coloring. And just, it's got depth to it, right? It feels very three-dimensional, but at the same time, very energetic and comic booky. X-Force has been one of my favorite X-Men books. It continues to do so. I'm really loving the ideas. I'm really loving the usage of these characters and their relationships to each other. X-Force number 16, pretty freaking solid. Cable number 7. Cable number 7 was okay. Phil Noto doing nice, crisp, clean artwork. That's nice. I like his a little bit more watercolory fade out pastel-y type stuff. I prefer that, but it seems like this one gets the job done, and Alfil Noto is actually a very prolific artist and pumping out more pages per month than a lot of other artists. But Cable number 7 was okay. Well, Cable's getting back to the gist of things, and it almost is kind of it's very unnerving almost at times to read this book and be like, oh, that's right, there are all these like kidnapped mutant children that just got left dangling out there because Ten of Swords. But anyway, they get back to that. Some interesting developments on the character of Cable, especially post-Ten of Swords. This is a Cable that's not as seasoned as we're used to. We're used to that older Cable, the more seasoned, the veteran. That's not what he is. And that was his first real close brush up probably with death. Well, not his first, obviously, but dude thought he was gone in Ten of Swords. And you kind of still feel that going through. Plus, and I'm sure you can already piece it together, but the return of a Robbie favorite and fan favorite Cable villain is promised in this issue. And I could not be more excited. I'll tell you what, though. There was some real... The last X-Force run that was done by Ed Brisson was fantastic. And I really hope that they kind of can get back to some of those elements with this character. But overall, Cable is all right. I'm liking it. It's not my favorite X-Book, but it's not my least favorite. So there you go. Avengers number 41 is here. I am getting tired of this book. 100%. I think it's almost official. I don't want to make it through, because I do like the idea that Jason Aaron's come up with of the different totems. The Black Panther, the Spirit of Vengeance, the Sorcerer Supreme, the Iron Fist. There are all these totems that are passed down through humanity's history. The Star Brand, all that. Really fascinating. He's taking his sweet time to seem to get to what he's actually trying to build with that. Whatever, that's okay. Avengers has had some ups, it's had some downs. It's been a very inconsistent book, but it's been, at times, an enjoyable book. This Enter the Phoenix story, which we're now in a part two of, not been exciting me at all. I am not ready for another Phoenix story, and this one, the Phoenix, is gathering a bunch of heroes and villains together to, like, do a tournament, so the Phoenix gives them a little bit of their power, and they fight, and it's trying to see who the ultimate host of the Phoenix is going to be. Been there, done that, tired of that, let's move on. Phoenix needs to be kept on hold for a while, I think, until it's relevant again. It can feel more impactful. Literally, if Galactus showed up in every single comic book every single month, he wouldn't be a threat. You get what I'm saying? So there's been way too much Phoenix over the last several years, and this one, to me, just feels lackluster, feels thrown together, and it feels like an excuse for Hasbro and Marvel to sell more toys. Let's jump over to DC Comics. Not that there's anything wrong with that. I love a good occasional Hasbro Marvel toy. We got Future State rolling on through. We got our first second issue of a Future State book, and it's the next Batman. Now, controversy aside, because $7.99 for a Batman story and then two other full-size stories, but two other stories that you didn't really want, that kind of rubbed people the wrong way. You are not going to like issue number two then, because I loved the initial story in number one. I loved the next Batman story. Mostly anchored, that opinion was, I think, on the cool concepts and the ideas. I like the magistrate. I like all that stuff. But Nick Darrington and Tamara Bond Villain's artwork was fantastic. Now, they're gone. They're already gone. We got Laura Braga and Breakdowns by Nick Darrington. But the artwork in here, it gets the job done. It does what it's supposed to do. But it doesn't have the pop and the flair and the panache of issue number one story. So to me, it lost a very integral design component to what was so fascinating to me about that world and about that comic. Also, the backup stories, the Batgirl story is okay, but it does kind of redeem itself towards the end, but it's completely misusing spoiler. It's written by Vita Ayala. I really respect their work. I just thought that the choices there were a little, I don't know, it was all right. And then the Gotham City Siren story was, to me, even more boring and dull than the Arkham Knight story from the one before. So once again, $7.99, they changed the artist, which changes to me the whole tone and feel and even scope of the book. The story is still okay. They're doing some decent stuff there. Like I said, Braga's not doing a bad job. It's just the whole aesthetic and tone is just gone in issue number two. So this is going to be a really, really hard one there. Then we got another $8 comic. It's called Superman Worlds at War, Worlds of War. And I'm going to tell you this. I hate saying this because this is a $7.99 comic book that is not worth $7.99. Because it's got a Midnighter story that's okay. It ties in a little bit to a Mr. Miracle story, but the Mr. Miracle story takes place after the second issue of Superman and Metropolis's Mr. Miracle story, so we've got a gap there, but whatever, that doesn't really bother me too much. The Midnighter story is decent enough, but I don't see why you put a Midnighter story in a Superman book, and then a Black Racer story. It's a completely new interpretation of the character that I found intriguing enough, but by the time I got to the end of this page count, I was so bored and dulled out. But what really was fascinating to me about this book was that I thought that this Superman story, the main story, was the best Superman story I have read in years. Seriously, loved this story. Now, I loved what Tomasi was doing over at Rebirth, right? Then Bendis came in, and he had some decent stuff at first, and I feel like that just really petered out. I really like this. So this is if this gives me any kind of hope for Philip Kennedy Johnson's upcoming run on Superman in Action, it does 110%. So Philip Kennedy Johnson is the writer of the main story, which I just absolutely found fantastic. It's about these people who have been saved by Superman. Superman's missing at this point in the timeline, and they're all kind of coming up with their own stories and maybe what is... It's almost like that one story in the Batman Gotham Knight animated movie where the three different kids are telling their own story about where... What Superman or Batman is to them, and then where they think he is. That's what they're doing with Superman here. Mikael Hannan's artwork was great. It felt big. It felt epic. And when you got to the end, I was so ready to read issue number 2. I'll tell you what, though. I don't think many people are going to like those backup stories. They feel cluttered. They feel not connected. Yeah, they're connected in a little bit of way because, you know, War World's involved a little bit. You can tell from the cover, but... Man, I really liked this Superman story. It's a shame that most people aren't going to check it out because it's an $8 book. It's not worth $8, but that Superman story was awesome. Then we have the Immortal Wonder Woman. Number 1, this one's written by Becky Cloonan, Will Conrad, and it's got artwork by Jen Bartel. The artwork by Jen Bartel is absolutely gorgeous. I'm a big fan of her work, her colors, the line work. It's nice, right? Her interpretation of Darkseid, to me, is not quite my favorite. He looks a little too bumpy in a weird, more too cute kind of way at times. But the artwork was really so solid. The story's okay. It's Wonder Woman at the end of time. She's the immortal Wonder Woman. She's dealing with things at the end of time, the end of the earth, whatever, right? And it was okay. Then there's got this Nubia story in the back that was okay. You know, it's introducing the idea of this character taking on the mantle of Wonder Woman at some point in the future. And that's cool. She's a character from Themyscira, obviously, but... That one was just okay to me, and the main story, like, the story didn't do much for me, but the artwork was fantastic. It's $5.99 because it's 2 full stories, but I don't think it was near as good as the Yara Floor stuff that we've gotten. Catwoman number 1 from Future State, this one's written by Rom V, and Rom V does what he's been doing with Catwoman since he's taken it over, and it's basically come up with a cool, clever twist on a typical heist story and use it. You know, use Catwoman and building up this world. Catwoman's now in Alleytown. She's like a gang leader in the Rom V run. She's starting this group called the Strays, a bunch of kids. You know, she's teaching them to go around and be Robin Hoods, basically, right? Kind of molding the future generation of Catwomen and Catmen, right? So this kind of gives you like the end game, I guess, where Rom wants to take the story. It does that. It deals with the magistrate. It has a big connection to Dark Detective that I thought was really, really cool. In week 3 of Future State, which I do believe each week is getting steadily less exciting, but they are now starting to find a connective tissue betwixt each other. Betwixt? Between each other. Catwoman is pretty solid. I thought it was dope. It's not... If you're reading the Rom V Catwoman run, I would encourage you to check it out. If you're reading Dark Detective, you might want to check it out because there's some cool overlap there. But Catwoman was pretty solid. I liked it. Nightwing I didn't like. I did not like Future State Nightwing. This is by Will Constant. I believe Nicola Scott doing the artwork. So there's some really nice pages artistically. This is obviously like all Bat books are set in the Magistrate era. Let's just call it that. Dick's take on the Magistrate is to go super dark, and this is something that's happened in the Teen Titans Future State book, which I think takes place after this a little bit, but it's like, why is DC so fascinated with turning Dick Grayson into this dark, edgy character? Really, why? Is it because of the Titan show? Because that Titan show, as successful as I guess it is to be entering its 3rd season, it's not like supremely successful. So Dick Grayson is not the one who's going to be beaten down by all the bad stuff that happens. And like what they've been doing in Future States there, and even before when they did the Rick Grayson stuff, somebody at DC is like, we got to make him edgy and dark and, you know, F Batman. And that's not the Dick Grayson that comic book fans love. That's not the Dick Grayson that charm and that joyfulness, which that exuberant joyfulness that so many fans of Dick Grayson's, of Nightwing, of Rob, of his Robin, of Teen Titans, even like, that's not the, you know, it's so removed from that. It's so weird. And I'm just so curious, like, why are they doing this? I get it. The Magistrate's bad, but man, like Tim Drake still felt like Tim in Robin Eternal. And this just, I don't know, man. These Future State books with Dick Grayson, I just feel like they're way off the mark with his character or how that character would respond to certain things. I don't know. They just got this thing. They want to make him edgy. Future State Shazam. What? I did not like this one. I was excited to check this one out. It's written by Tim Sheridan or Sheridan. So I believe that it's connected in a way to the Teen Titans one. It's not like no Red X or nothing, but it is connected to some of those events in Teen Titans. I can't remember how it fits in the timeline, but I was rather confused by this one. There's this big crazy reveal at the end, and it's supposed to be like a jaw-dropping, like, what if, like, what crate, like, WTF type moment, but like, it's not. It's just a, huh? And like, I did not like this one at all. So maybe it was just good for this book to go away after John's wrapped up his run. Over at DC Black Label, though, we got Rorschach. We got some non-Future State books. And oddly enough, the best DC books this week were the non-Future State ones. So we got Rorschach number 4. I'm loving this one. We all got mixed feelings about DC continuously capitalizing on the Watchmen and those characters. And Tom King can be a divisive writer out there. Jorge Fornes and Dave Stewart, though, it's kind of well assumed by most people. They are fantastic artists. But I'm really liking Rorschach. It's doing something completely different than the Watchmen did or any other interpretation of the Watchmen. Seriously, doing its own thing, doing something different. And I think this is where Tom King excels, is these limited edition, you know, like 12-issue series, usually involving characters that nobody cares about. This book is about Rorschach, but more about Rorschach as an idea. So you're getting more of the backstory of certain characters here. The mystery is deepening. You're understanding more about what the story is about, but at the same time, it's really hard to peg down what this is actually about, aside from just some really great explorations on the identity and character of Rorschach and what that could and would represent to different people. Rorschach number 4 was fantastic. Jorge Fornes, Dave Stewart, by the way, fantastic artist. Another Tom King book this week that was rather good, Batman Catwoman number 2. I loved this book. I really had a love-hate relationship with Tom King's Batman run. I thought some of it was absolutely spectacular. I thought some of it was drawn out and just meaningless and filler. But now, when you give them a 12-issue series, this is set out of continuity, so not as much editorial oversight. This is really solid. You got 3 stories going on. Let's just say one takes place in the present, one takes place in the past, and one takes place in the future. And this is basically assuming that Batman and Catwoman do get married and live out that life that Tom King revealed in that excellent annual from his run of Batman. But it's filling all the gaps in between. It's rooted in tragedy. It's got a great Christmas theme to it. This one, for instance, is called Up on the Housetop, which I love because the first one was Silent Night. So when this wraps up on Christmas time, it's going to come full circle back around Christmas time. So that's going to be really cool. And Phantasm. Phantasm is in here. And oh my goodness, are they awesome. Everything about Phantasm in this book blows me away, but Selena's character is so well utilized here by Tom King, and he has such an understanding of this character at this point for this story, and I'm loving it. This book should be called Catwoman Batman, but it's really solid, and I'm excited to see more of this Phantasm story flourish. Right? DCeased Dead Planet number 7. This is the final issue of the series and could very well be the final issue of DCeased, period. This would be the perfect ending for all of it. Now, I don't want that to happen because I absolutely love what Tom Taylor has done. He's done the impossible. He's taken a what-if, Elseworldy type story that we shouldn't really care about and gave it so much gravitas and excitement and tragedy and hope and optimism and despair and defeat. And it's all there so perfectly encapsulated. And then he's been able to take that on and do a legacy version of it. And he's built up Jonathan Kent as Superman, and he's built up Cassie as Wonder Woman, and he's built up Damian as Batman way better than any Future State book has done as far as legacy, and he's doing a fantastic job. And you got some amazing John Constantine work in this issue. Great stuff. DCeased Dead Planet number 7. Sad to see it end. I hope it comes back, because there's obviously always room for this book to come back. But man, what a great finale. And all of DCeased by Tom Taylor has been amazing. Let's jump over to Boom, where we have Abbott 1973 number 1, written by Saladin Ahmed, with artwork by Sammy Cavella, Mattia Iacono on the coloring, and Jim Campbell on the lettering. So Abbott 1973, first and foremost, is a sequel to this book called Abbott. Abbott was on my top 10 list of 2018, if I do remember the date correctly. Abbott was a great 70s set, supernatural crime noir set in Detroit that dealt with a lot of the political issues of the time in, as far as the city and the black community in the city. Abbott was a fantastic book, and it's got a great supernatural tinge to it. And now it's finally back 2-3 years later as a sequel, Abbott 1973. This is a story set in the very next year, and right from the bat, just drawn back in. Now, if you've never read the original Abbott, they do a great job on the first couple pages here of recapping everything from the original one, right? So you could really, I feel, jump in here, get caught up on just the recap, and then enjoy the book for what it is. First of all, what is the book? It's a great character. Abbott is an investigative journalist. She has also got this attachment to the supernatural. She finds out more about that in the first one, and it sets up a lot of adventures to come. This is that next adventure. And it just picks up right where the last book left off. The voice is still true. The voice of the character Abbott and the voice of the city, because the city of Detroit is as much of a character in this book as the main title character. I love it. Sam Michivella has a great way with composition and doing really innovative type things. If you liked the artwork in Undone by Blood, for instance, which was one of my favorite comic books of last year, that's the same cat. Unfortunately, we have a different colorist here. Mattea Iacono does a decent job, but Jason Wordy, who is Cavella's colorist, on Undone by Blood and on the original, provides, I feel, a little bit more of an extra texture and dimension as opposed to Mattea's coloring. The coloring's not bad, and there is definitely elements and etherealness in certain scenes, but for the most part, it doesn't give me quite as much nuance through the coloring as the first one. But that's just an artistic critique right there on the change of the colorist. Aside from that, I loved this book, and even if you haven't read the first one, I would encourage you to check this out, but I would highly encourage you to check out Abbott, because the original series was one of my favorite comics in 2018, and I'm very excited for it to be back, because remember, journalists are detectives for the people. Once in Future is here with issue number 15. This is a little bit more of a, this is the lull issue. Not that it's bad, it's a fantastic issue. Two great conversations are had by two sets of characters, some really cool ideas. It's got some action, it's got great artwork. Dan Mora, Tamara Bond villain, killing it. The best art team in comics right now. I'm serious, I think that they can do no wrong. Everything is so clean and precise and just perfect. I love it. And Karen Gillan's doing a great job of what started out as an inversion of accepted Arthurian legend. And then it delved out into other mythology and folklore. Now it's kind of circling back and doing interesting and new things with the Camelot type stuff. Lancelot, for instance. Really great book. I'm loving it. This is a little bit of a lull. So there's a lot of questions answered here, but a lot of questions raised, and a lot of exciting moments in setting certain things up for where they need to go for the second half of Arc 3. Once in Future has been one of the best books on shelves since it first started. It put Boom on the map again, along with Something is Killing the Children and other titles. But Once in Future number 15 was solid. Solid like a rock. Power Rangers number 3 is here. Ryan Parrott doing what he's doing, just crafting the best Power Rangers stories, adventures, characterizations we have literally ever had. Ever. This stuff honestly probably even top Super Sentai, but I don't want to admit it. The artwork by Francisco Mortarino is great because it's got a sleek sense of action and adventure. This is a very much a sci-fi book because this is the space-oriented one. This one deals with space vampires, or they're extra-dimensional, like space parasites, dimensional parasites. It's a very Morrison-y idea, kind of thrown in to a Power Rangers book, which I think is really, really cool. And I mean Morrison-y idea because it's literally what he did in Final Crisis. Power Rangers number 3, I'm really liking it. If you're a Power Rangers fan of new or old, I think you'll find something to enjoy. And the twists and turns just keep happening. What about that Mateo Scalera cover? That's fantastic. From Dark Horse, we have Crimson Flower number 1. This is a new one from Matt Kent. I don't know what to make of this one, to be honest. It's got artwork, first of all, by Matt Lesniewski, which I don't think many people are going to like this art. A lot of people that really like know of some older, like, old, if you liked indie comics in the 90s especially, I think you'll find something artistically to vibe with on this book. Story-wise, it's intriguing. I don't understand it, really. It's kind of confusing, to be honest. It's basically the story of this woman taking revenge on the person that she's hunting down, the person that killed her father. But there's another element to it, right? And the art doesn't help the confusion because the art is very expressive and the art does things that don't make sense physically, but it's doing it because that's the flow of the art, and I appreciate that. But the book left me kind of with more questions than anything else at the end. More questions and zero interest. Like, I'm kind of interested to see what's going to happen because I trust Matt Kent. But I don't know what was going on there. Barb Alien, Red Planet, number 3 from the world of Black Hammer is here. I'm really liking this book. I thought the first issue was okay, but the second issue really started taking it into a better direction, I thought. And then the third issue just hits all of those emotional bits. And I love it. So this is the story of Barb Alien. He's basically the Martian Manhunter of the Black Hammer universe. But imagine if Martian Manhunter was a gay man, right? And that's not cool on Mars. And then he comes to Earth in the 80s and the AIDS epidemic, and it's not cool then either, right? So it's dealing with that struggle. It's dealing with the struggle of AIDS victims. It's dealing with the struggle of the homosexual community during this time. It's dealing with what it's like to be an outsider and to find a family amongst other outsiders. This book is a great exploration on what it's doing. And it's about alienation and how we alienate people from us. There's a heartbreaking scene in here. The opening scene, because it deals with a doctor who runs a clinic, and she's literally like one of the only people who will take care of these dying AIDS victims with any kind of respect and dignity. And there's a powerful scene at the beginning of this book that takes me back to things like powerful moments in Rent. So Barb Alien, Red Planet, number 3. Kudos. Really like that. Jeff Lemire, of course, with Tate Bromball as the writer as well, and Gabriel Hernandez, Walter Jordi Belair, Aditya Bidikar. Really cool stuff there. You Look Like Death, Tales from the Umbrella Academy, issue number 5, the penultimate issue. This book's been weird, it's been wild, it's been wacky. Not as weird, wild, and wacky as we typically expect from an Umbrella Academy book, but this is not a main Umbrella Academy book. It's like a side story because, you know, Dark Horse is like, please, Gerard, just we need an Umbrella Academy. There's a show out. There was the pandemic. We're trying to come back. We need it, right? So it's a fun book. I'm really liking the story. I'm really liking the artwork. It's a nice side Klaus story. It doesn't add a lot to the texture or the tapestry, I should say, of the Umbrella Academy mythos, but it is pretty fun and nifty, and it scratches that zany, weird indie itch that I have that actually gets scratched all the time. So You Look Like Death, number 5, is out this week. From Image Comics, we have Rain Like Hammers, number 1. This is another one that I found very weird. Brandon Graham, I'm familiar with his work. I was excited to check this one out. Definitely not going to be for everybody, but it looks like a really cool sci-fi indie book. It's trying, I think, to say something about humanity and isolation. And routine and the tragedy of it at the same time, but at the same time, the enamor of it, right? The glamour of it. But Rain Like Hammers was really hard to follow and understand what exactly was going on. The artwork was fine. I like the artwork. It's not going to be to everybody's taste, but the story just was really out there. And to me, it never really cohesively came together. And it's going to be difficult to justify going back to a second dip on that one. Stillwater number 5 is here with the penultimate issue of its first arc. Once again, just a lot of talking in this book, but I find it fascinating. Part of that, I do believe, is Ramon K. Perez and Mike Spicer's artistic work. Even for people just sitting in a city hall talking throughout most of the issue, it's kind of exciting. And the drama, what's going on, and the characters that have been fleshed out, the characters of this town, that had been fleshed out by Chip Zdarsky. It's really nice. And I used to think that Chip had a very verbose style. And you can still look at it sometimes and see that there, but he's really ironed a lot of all those kinks out. And he's becoming one of the best comic book writers in the biz right now. Stillwater number 5 is a fantastic issue. It's really taken the story into a different direction, a direction that was not quite as expected so soon. And I'm really excited. Stillwater number 5, if you've been liking it, I think you're going to continue to like it. So there you go. The Scumbag, issue number 4, right? Yes, issue number 4, The Scumbag, promises an orgy on the cover, and it delivers on that promise. So kudos to a book for delivering on its promise set about by the cover. The art in this one was good. You had a different artist. It's Boshi. What's his name? Roland Boshi, Marino Denisio. I've messed up those names, I'm sure. I really am liking this book. It is raunchy. It is raw. It is crude. It is rude. It is in your face. It is drug-fueled, sex-addicted, rock and roll right in your face. But at the same time, it's got some charm to it. I think it's actually going to wind up with some character work. It's got an interesting concept. But the basic premise is this. There's this dude who's just a complete scumbag. He's like, think about the most embarrassing person in your family, amp that up 100,000 times, and now you have the scumbag. And he winds up with this nanite formula, which he thinks is just drugs, so he thinks he's shooting up drugs, but he winds up with this nanotechnology inside that gives him superpowers. So this organization, who's trying to save the world, they need his help. And he's got all kinds of crazy requests. The Scumbag is not going to be for everybody, but it's for me. I'm having a lot of fun with it. Issue 4, I thought, was wild, rambunctious, loud, absurd, offensive. Pretty freaking awesome. We Live, number 4, is here with what I consider the weakest issue of the series yet. Now, when I say that, I'm not saying it's a bad issue, but this issue for 3 solid issues has been blowing me away. Issue 4, I thought, was okay. It was pretty decent. There are some really powerful moments here, though. There's one moment in here. You'll know what I'm talking about if you read it. There's an emotional moment in here that is incredibly powerful. So kudos for that. But it starts kind of doing some... It does do what the series has been doing, which is taking us in roads, down roads that we're not expecting. So once again, unexpected things happen. The story goes this way and that way, and you're not seeing it coming. But it was all right. It didn't quite hit me like 1, 2, and 3 did. But maybe it's because it's been 4 issues now and we're gearing up for something, but I'm still liking it. The artwork was good, but it didn't seem quite as sleek as some of the previous issues. But I am liking this book. I'm liking it a lot. Some really cool ideas. And like I said, twists and turns behind every single thing. These poor kids. These poor kids. We Live, number 4 from Aftershock. Serial number 1 came out last week. My shop was shorted. But we finally got our copies, and I wanted to check it out because I am a fan of Terry Moore's work, especially Motor Girl and Rachel Rising. Serial's really well done, aside from the fact that when it ends, I'm completely confused about what the hell's actually going on. But the first 2/3 of this book are marvelous, right? It's Terry Moore doing what Terry Moore does, but he does a story. You think it's one thing, it turns into another thing, but it actually turns into another thing. And then at the end, I think it's turning into another thing, but is it? What's going on? It's kind of confusing at the end. I don't know if it's going to be enough of a hook to bring people back in for issue number 2, but just based on his previous work, Terry Moore is definitely someone worth looking for it in the long run. So Serial is definitely one I'm going to keep my eye on. Issue 1 came out last week. I think it sold out, but luckily we got our copies in. So if you get a chance, check it out. And if you've already checked it out, let me know what you think. From AWA, we have American Roan in number 4, the penultimate issue. I'm liking this one. It's Pete Milligan. It's Aco on the artwork. The artwork is nice. It's a different style than sometimes what we see. Maybe it has something to do with the colorist. Is he not the colorist? But I'm liking the book. Really cool composition. Really cool panel design and layout. And I like that. The colorist is Dean White. Maybe that's what it is. It does have some nice coloring in there as well, but it's got a cool premise. It's Pete Milligan kind of doing what I love Pete Milligan for, which is really crazy ideas that have at times subversive takes and at times inverted takes, but at the same time, just a nice, sleek, fun action story, spy thriller, corporate espionage. But what if the world was run by corporations? Well, what if, right? What if? But American Ronin is a really cool concept. It's almost done. Got one more issue. I'm excited to see how it wraps up. And we have bite-sized number 2 of 4 from AWA. This is Cullen Bunn, Nelson Blake II, Snakebite Cortez. I'm really liking this one. The second issue is cute. It's charming. It is very much like a Gremlins type thing. The dog's name in this book, for instance, name is Gizmo, right? So this book knows what it's doing, but it's about this family at Christmas time, and they get this like little alien robot shows up, and the little girl finds it, and she's trying to befriend it, and this mystery. And so it's got these E.T. meets Gremlins type vibes. It feels Spielbergian, but with that Cullen Bunn touch and a nice bit towards the end. I'm liking this book. I thought the second issue was actually actually way better than the first. It is a Christmas story, so you know how that is. Christmas is over, and here we are reading Christmas stories. But it's okay, because when the trade comes out, you can sit down and read it during Christmas. But anyway, Bite Size number 2 I thought was pretty freaking solid. So that's what I read this week. That's what I thought about it. What are you reading? What are you digging? Let us know in the comments down below. Thank you so much for checking out the video. Please be sure to like, share, and subscribe. Click the notification bell so you don't miss a single video. And join us over at popculturephilosophers.com for podcast blogs and a whole lot more. I've been Rockin' Robbie Billups. Thanks for rocking with us. Keep on reading.